Good morning or afternoon, everyone. On this Resurrection Sunday, this Easter Sunday, I actually had got a lot to think about and sing about today. I was going to throw this in somewhere in the middle, but I think it's best to open with this today. And I got a kind of a special announcement I'll do first here. We've gone international. Or I should say, I've gone international. Not really, kind of. I mean, YouTube is accessible and Facebook is accessible all over the world, right? Well, I got a comment on one of these videos on YouTube from someone in Switzerland. So thank you. Get y'all. Please keep watching. I love it. I love it. Yeah, Switzerland. That's amazing. But this is kind of relevant to today. Kind of gives it away, especially if you've seen the movie Ben-Hur. A couple things in this remind me of that. But it has something. It mentions the guy in this who is an obvious allegory for someone else that we know of. Says he's good looking. Well, the Bible's very clear he was not. But I think for the sake of this little story thing is pretty cool. It's called Ragman by Walter Wangren Jr. And I guess he's like a really good orator or something. Just some of the way that this stuff is done. So I'm going to do my very best dramatic reading. Okay? I saw a strange sight. And I stumbled upon a story most strange. Like nothing my life, my street sense, and my sly tongue had ever prepared me for. Hush, child, hush now, and I will tell it to you. Even before the dawn, one Friday morning, I noticed a young man, handsome and strong, walking the alleys of our city. He was pulling an old cart filled with clothes, both bright and new. And he was calling in a clear tenor voice, "Rags!" Ah, the air was foul, and the first light filthy to be crossed by such sweet music. "Rags, new for old, I take your tired rags. Rags, please." "Now this is a wonder," I thought to myself, for the man stood 6'4", and his arms looked like they were great tree limbs, hard and muscular. And his eyes flashed intelligence. Could he find no better job than this? To be a ragman in the inner city? I followed him. My curiosity drove me. And I wasn't disappointed. Soon the ragman saw a woman sitting on her back porch. She was sobbing into a handkerchief, sighing and shedding a thousand tears. Her knees and elbows made a sad X shape. Her shoulders shook. Her heart was breaking. The ragman stopped his cart and quietly walked down to the woman, stepping around tin cans, dead toys, and Pampers. "Give me your rag," he said, so gently, "and I'll give you another." He slipped the handkerchief from her eyes. She looked up, and he laid across her palm a linen cloth so clean and new that it shined. She blinked from the gift to the giver. Then, as he began to pull his cart again, the ragman did a strange thing as he put her stained handkerchief to his own face. And then he began to weep and to sob as grievously as she had done, his shoulders shaking. She was left without a tear. "This is a wonder," I breathed to myself. And I followed the sobbing ragman like a child who cannot run away from mystery. "Rags! Rags! New for old! New rags for old!" In a little while, when the sky showed gray behind the rooftops, I could see the shredded curtains hanging out black windows. The ragman came upon a girl whose head was wrapped in a bandage, whose eyes were empty. Blood soaked her bandage. A single line of blood ran down her cheek. Now the tall ragman looked upon this child with pity, and he drew a lovely yellow bonnet from his cart. "Give me your rag," he said, tracing his own line on your cheek, "and I'll give you mine." The child could only gaze at him while he loosened the bandage, removed it, and tied it to his own head. The bonnet he set on hers. And I gasped at what I saw, for with the bandage went the wound. Against his brow, it ran darker and more substantial. Blood, his own. Rags! Rags! I take old Rags! Cried the sobbing, bleeding, strong, intelligent Ragman. The sun hurt both the sky. Now and my eyes, the Ragman seemed more and more to hurry. Are you going to work? He asked the man who leaned against the telephone pole. The man shook his head. The Ragman pressed him. Do you have a job? Are you crazy? Sneered the other. He pulled away from the pole, revealing the right sleeve of his jacket, flat, the cuff stuffed into the pocket. He had no arm. So, the Ragman, said the Ragman, give me your jacket, and I'll give you mine. Such quiet authority in his voice. The one-armed man took off his jacket, and so did the Ragman, and I trembled at what I saw, for the Ragman's arm stayed in its sleeve, and when the other put it on, he had two good arms, thick as tree limbs. But the Ragman only had one. Go to work, he said. After that, he found the drunk lying unconscious beneath an army blanket. An old man hunched, wizened, and sick. He took that blanket and wrapped it around himself, but for the drunk he left new clothes. And now I had to run to keep up with the Ragman, though he was weeping uncontrollably and bleeding freely from the forehead and pulling his cart with one arm, stumbling for drunkenness, falling again and again, exhausted, old and sick, and yet he went with terrible speed. On spider's legs, he skidded through the alleys of the city, this mile and the next, until he came to its limits and then rushed beyond. I wept to see the change in this man. I hurt to see his sorrow, and yet I needed to see where he was going in such haste. Perhaps to know what drove him so. The little old ragman, he came to a landfill. He came to the garbage pits, and then I wanted to help him in what he did, but I hung back, hiding. He climbed a hill. With tormented labor, he cleared a little space on that hill. He sighed, and he lay down. He pillowed his head on a handkerchief and jacket. He covered his bones with an army blanket, and he died. Oh, how I cried to witness that death! I slumped in a junkered car and wailed and mourned as one who had no hope, because I had come to love the Ragman. Every other face had faded in the wonder of this man, and I cherished him, but he died, and I sobbed myself to sleep. I did not know, how could I know, that I slept through Friday night, and Saturday, and it's night too. But then on Sunday morning, I was awakened by a violence. Light, pure, hard, demanding light, slammed against my sour face, and I blinked, and I looked, and I saw the last and the first wonder of it all. Good song. But there was the Ragman, folding the blanket most carefully, and a scar on his forehead, but alive. And besides that, healthy. There was no sign of sorrow, nor of age, and of all the rags that he had gathered, shine for cleanliness. Well, then I lowered my head, and trembling for all that I had seen, I myself walked up to the Ragman and told him my name with shame, for I was a sorry figure next to him. And then I took off all my clothes in that place, and I said to him with dear yearning in my voice, "Dress me." He dressed me. My lord, he put new rags on me, and I, in a wonder beside him, the Ragman, the Christ. A beautiful allegory to the gospel story. And I was actually trying to practice a song that I was thinking about singing in church, but no one had asked me, so I didn't. But I've done it in a video before called Watch the Lamb, and I couldn't get through it the other day without crying, so beautiful thing. You know, I wasn't planning on doing that Easter video per se, but all of these songs have something to do with Easter. So it was really good to have them. I noticed I had a couple of viewers coming in and out. Go back to the beginning, please, and watch. This is a wonderful little thing here. I love it. But I guess I could call this my Easter video this today. And I hope I've worked a little bit. I haven't probably worked as hard as I should, but it has been hard trying to find time to practice lately, and especially yesterday. I was going to do this video yesterday. I'm glad I didn't, because I only got this morning before church, kind of during our Easter morning celebrations from a guy who's been coming to our church named John, Air Force veteran, worked on airplanes, aircraft mechanic, good guy. But I'd like to start this morning. You know, it mentioned how he said, "I felt unworthy and walked with shame." The devil, Satan, and the powers of this world like to use the fact. It's a fact. There are many facts and truths. But they're the fact of our unworthiness. Satan will use the fact of our unworthiness of what Christ has done and our unworthiness of heaven to stop us from claiming the promises of the Bible. He's done it to me for over 30 years. I was a Christian. At least I accepted the gift of salvation, but the gift of power in my life, the gift of the Spirit, I have been shut off to because Satan had me convinced that you can't have it. You're a loser. You don't deserve it. I mean, of course, that's the whole point. It's a fact. Don't deserve it. But it does not matter. Not to Jesus. It's the fact, and we use that fact to rob you of joy, peace, and everything else. Don't let the fact that we're not worthy of heaven and we're not worthy of the gift of Jesus. We're not. But he did it anyway. He did it anyway. That is why the gospel is so attractive to me and a lot of people like me. It doesn't matter how unworthy we are. It does not. That's what, you know, that song, it's taken me so long to realize the truth of because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because I, growing up with both clinical depression and circumstantial depression, I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. A lot of times as a kid, I felt God's blessings don't apply to me, but his punishments do. And that is a lie straight out the pits of hell. It's a lie straight from the devil. So, I think that's why, I don't even realize it at the time, I think that's why God had me choose this song this morning. Start the video after that lovely little, I don't even know if it's called a poem, but that lovely little reading that I did. So, when my life's work is ended and I cross the swelling tide, when the high, bright and glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and his smile will be the first to welcome me. I shall know him, I shall know him, and redeemed by his side I shall stand. I shall know him, I shall know him, by the print of the nails in his hand. Oh, the soul thrilling rapture when I view his blessed face, and the luster of his kindly beaming eyes. How my full heart will praise him for his mercy, love, and grace that prepares me for a mansion in the sky. I shall know him, I shall know him, and redeemed by his side I shall stand. I shall know him, I shall know him, by the prints of the nails in his hand. Through the gates unto the city, in a robe of spotless white, he will lead me where no tears shall ever fall. In the gladness song of ages I shall mingle with delight, but I long to meet my Savior first of all. I shall know him, I shall know him, and redeemed by his side I shall stand. I shall know him, I shall know him, by the print of the nails in his hand. Oh, what a song. And I don't want to leave it without sharing this with you. This is written by a woman named Fanny J's Crosby, and I've shared in my videos before, but there's been so many of them, I can't expect new fans to watch all of them. She wrote probably more hymns than anyone else. She actually had a couple of pen names. You might know some of her poems. But she was blind. She was blind, and so when I long to meet my Savior, first of all, and the first face I see. She literally, she used to have this phrase. She says, oh, you're one of the lucky ones. When she would meet another blind person, you're like, what are you talking about? Especially if they knew Jesus. Because Jesus will be the first face you get to see. Yes, it's sad. It is devastating to be blind. Especially from birth. Not even knowing what you're missing. I can understand how that can make you depressed. But if you know Christ as Savior and you have no eyes, or eyes at least that don't work, let me promise you, you have a great privilege that none of us do not have. You may not see a single face in this life, but the first one you get to see is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that should fill you with joy. Why? Because it is. This life is fleeting. As long as it feels, it is so short. But anyway, this next song, I have a longing. I've had it for a very long time, and like Paul says, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. We gain something. We're better off. The Christian. If you don't know Christ as Savior, you're not a believer. I'm sorry, but it's one of those facts that's not pleasant. Dying for you would not be a good thing. You may be in pain, your body may be broken. It's far worse without Christ. See, here's the other thing about Christ. He may not take the trouble away, but he can give you peace in your trouble. And I've sung about that, and I've talked about that before. But and this song is a crying, and I love it. So let's, yeah.
As I journey through the land, singing as I go, 20 souls to Calvary, to the crimson glow. Soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, to him I must win. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of saving grace. as all pass, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'm paying close to Him, He will give me light. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes on ahead, leads for every time. Saving grace on the streets of glory. Let me lift my voice. Cares all pass, home at last, ever to rejoice. When the valleys flow, I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, leading in the fight. When a tender outstretched hand toward the valley low, guiding me, I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, let us sing forever unsaving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all pass, home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, let the Lord direct my heart, He the safely keep, and He leads me gently on world below. He's a real friend to me, oh, I love Him so. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, let Him sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all pass, home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, of the saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all pass, home at last, ever to rejoice.
Because it's a great desire. I can honestly not wait until it's time to go home to heaven. And while I have in the past been tempted to usher that journey on, I have not. It's been hard. Oh, whoops, wrong thing. Oh, I want to see Him, because He is oh, what a Savior. And this was a challenging song to find and get, and I'm still not completely happy with it, but I'm sure we'll have another chance at some point to do it. It's such a great song. So a lot of people have done it. I know I'm not nothing special, but I just like this song so much, and I think, given that it's Resurrection Day, it's a good thing, so. Whoops, I messed it up. I need God's grace every day. I screw up daily. Sometimes every hour, at least. A bad thought, a wrong word. Just ask people I work with sometimes. I'm ashamed to say they probably wonder if I even am a Christian, and that's not right. And that's where grace comes in. I need it. We all do. Anyways.
He gave His life's blood for even me. Sin's dark valley, no hope within. Could I see? They searched through heaven. Savior to save a poor lost soul like me. Oh, what a Savior! Hallelujah. His heart was broken.
Sorry. Happens a lot during the change of the season, which we are going through really bad right now here in North Dakota. So, oh, what a savior. There's another song that comes to mind that's actually an idea for a later video, probably not my next one, considering how long it takes me to get these things ready and practiced and all that, but we'll see. But, actually, one of my next video will probably be at the end of May, probably the end of May, because I'm going to need all day to do it, on May 27th. It's in the middle of the week, but there's a reason for that. The nerds among you might know. But, I'm stepping on things I don't want to step on. Okay. But I sing a lot about Jesus, and the reason is I did not have an easy life. It's still not easy, but it's better. I won't argue that it's better. And some of it was my own fault. Some of it, a lot of it was not. I was born with a brain that didn't work quite right. Still better than a lot of people. But I struggle to understand basic concepts sometimes. I'm a slow learner. Except when it comes to sign language and music, so... I struggled learning. I struggled with my emotions. And so I need a lot of grace and a lot of help. And I love songs that have these concepts about heaven. When there's no more heartache, our understanding will be opened wide. That's what Jesus offers. He offers you peace in the middle of heartache and hardship and nonsense, and it doesn't matter what other people have done. Now, I saw something online. I can't even remember who posted it, believe it or not, but it doesn't matter. God's not going to ask you, in your turn, at the great white throne, about some other person's sin. He's going to ask them. No, they have to. Yes, things are sins. They have to answer for it. He's going to ask you, did you love them? Did you love them so much that they wanted Jesus so much that they turned from their sin? Because if not, then you did it wrong. That seems kind of harsh, I know. But Christians got to start being... I mean, Christians can preach the gospel, preach the truth, but they can't be so harsh to people who don't know no better. Jesus wants us to spread the gospel, yep. Tell people they need Jesus, yep. Tell if the subject comes up what their sin is, yep. But to do so in love. Ooh. Well, we do a lot of stuff like that. We do everything else, but I think sometimes we do it so militantly. There is coming a day. First line of the song, different subject. There is coming a day when the power is going to come down, the authority and the judgment. It's coming. But it's not up to you and me. Not up to us to bring that down. We're to tell. Tell people their need for Jesus. The Holy Spirit will convict them. We just got to tell them. The extent of our involvement. We take it so far. Yeah, this country, this world has turned away from God, and I kind of think, yeah, Satan's been the underlying cause, of course. He's in control of it, but I don't think we've helped matters. I include myself. I can't say, oh, you wicked fake Christians out there, oh, you messed my job up. No, I messed my job up. I've messed up a lot, not living like I should, not talking like I should. Maybe even saying some things. In fact, a couple times come to mind. I probably tried to share the truth in such an unloving way that... So, I include myself as one of us screw-ups. But there... Oh, what a savior. Oh, I want to see him. And oh, what a day that will be. When no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, all is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day. Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand, and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day.
that will be. There'll be no sorrow then, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness nor pain, and no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Oh, what a day that will be. And I really... I really can't wait. When I just see so much of the wickedness that goes, and it's unnecessary. I mean, I can understand jealousy and greed and all that, but some of it, I mean, I'm greedy. I'm jealous. Okay, I get that. When I see the level and the extent of it all, wickedness is wickedness, and it's easy to ignore. But when you see it to such extremes, you wonder, why? It's so unnecessary. It's sin. It'll take over your life. We can point to people who are evil, wicked, and greedy. Oh, look at how bad they are. Oh, look at that evil murderer. Look at that guy who's stealing. Well, they're stealing for desperation. They're stealing because I covet and I'm greedy. Okay, yeah, see? Look at that guy. The desperate one we can almost excuse because he's desperate. Oh, good Lord. Oh, man. Give him some money and send him on his way. His embarrassment is his punishment. Now, this Eve, this jerk. So that's why I long for the day when we see Jesus. That's another song I've sung. It will be worth it all when we see Christ. Oh. I can't say I hope so, because it will be worth it all. Life's trials will seem so small. But the thing I guess I should say hope for is that it happens quickly. But I can't be too greedy for that, because there are people who still need to respond. You might be one of them to the things that I talk and that I sing about. And, you know, I like to have fun, too. But I was trying to pick out songs for videos, and these are the ones that came up. Sometimes there's no rhyme or reason. I don't understand it. And yet sometimes I try to find themes or things that I think go together. And as I've said several times, we could be here for hours. All day, 2 days, while I have songs I think go together, have similar messages and stuff. So, but... And I, like I said, when I picked out these songs, I wasn't even thinking about an Easter video. And so, somehow they all have a great Easter message. Of course, technically speaking, our religion, our faith, is all about the risen Christ. So a lot of our songs have to do with the theme of Easter, the risen Lamb, Jesus being alive and helping us in our lives. So... Technically, all our songs are Christmas and Easter songs, technically speaking, but... And this song has the story of a woman who Jesus met her, and she was a woman rejected by even the people of her society, of her town. who were already the outcast. This was a Samaritan woman. And the Jews had nothing to do with it. They hated them. She was the outcast of a group of outcasts. And she'd had five husbands. And Jesus knew. And he told her. And the man you're with now ain't even married. You're not even married to him. I mean, back then, I mean, that was a big deal. And he says, you can give me water to drink, but I can offer you water where you will never thirst again. The water of life. Or living water. Living water. And so, and you know why? And this opening line of this song tells you she was looking for things that couldn't satisfy. Think about that. Ooh, think about that. But, well, I guess we'll just get, I do this a lot. I get into it. I get passionate. Because it's something, you know, some of you think I'm crazy or you've heard it. You're not really interested in Jesus. And that's fine. I get it. And I've been hesitant to share him because, again, so many Christians have messed it up. And I'm one of them. So I'm trying, I don't know if I'm trying to make up for that or just correct it or whatever. But it is so worth talking about. In this world that is so broken, and it sucks that it's broken. But by the same contrast, maybe it's a good thing because then we can see how wonderful Jesus is. The light shines in the darkest. In the darkest night is when the light shines brightest. If we all had all things all good and hunky-dory, we wouldn't think we needed him.
Seeking for things that could not satisfy, but then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that never shall run dry, fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. There are millions in this world who are craving the pleasure earthly things afford, but none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench the thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. So my brother, if the things this world gave you hunger that won't pass away, my blessed Lord will come and save you. If you kneel to him and humbly pray, fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and of my soul, bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole.
And now at the close, we're there already, right? Or finally, depending on how you look at it. Close. I know some people who watch this or these videos don't know Christ at all. That's okay. And there are some statements in this song that might apply to you. How long has it been since you had a good night's sleep and you woke up rested and refreshed? And if you're anything like me, it's been a long while. And it doesn't feel like it's possible. And sometimes that's our body. It's our health. We have to suffer the consequences of a wicked world. Choices if we don't eat healthy enough. Or bad medical care. Bad advice. Sometimes the consequences of actions aren't just our own actions, but someone else's actions. A doctor giving you the wrong advice or misdiagnosing you with, either because he's an idiot or because, the data shows, but you're slightly off. Mistakes happen. And there's one doctor out there, I don't think it's a mistake, I think he's just an arrogant jerk. My wife had surgery when she was about 8 or 9 years old. She died twice on the operating table to have her gallbladder removed. And it's caused a lot of health issues since. And every doctor she's seen knows this. And yet this doctor saw fit to say that all her problems were because of her weight. No, her weight is because of her gallbladder surgery and the different things over the last almost 30 years, 20-something years, have done. And then this doctor she saw the last week, not now, sweetheart, no. Your gallbladder being removed, you've got a buildup of some stuff. And if it is what I think it is, we can cure it. We can, not cure, but we can treat this with a simple medication. Been trying to lose weight all her life. So there's a difference out there. I don't even know why I started talking about this. That's dumb. Yeah, there are jerks out there. Yeah, we got on to health. I'm sorry. I did not mean to do that. But I love my wife. I hope if you are praying in person, you pray for her. She works overnights. It's hard on her body. But she's a bit of an insomniac anyway, so. But, ladies and gentlemen, I want to close with this song. And I know some of you, the answer to this is never. Never. But I hope that in some way it's soon. So. Let's see.
Since you talked with the Lord and told him your heart's hidden secret, how long since you prayed, how long since you stayed on your knees till the light shone through. How long has it been since your mind felt at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cares for you? How long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord? and would keep you the long night through. How long has it been since you woke with the dawn and felt that life's worth the living? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you?
Do you know that he cares for you? I don't know if I've said it before, but so many people wrote about Jesus. His existence is undeniable. He is a historical fact. But either he was the person who he said he was, or he was a terrible liar. He was not just a good teacher, because a good teacher would tell the truth. He may, from a world standpoint, maybe even your viewpoint, oh, he said many good things that people should do, and that's true. But either everything he said was the truth or nothing he said was the truth. How long, if ever, since you knew he cared? And he's proven himself. What a friend we have in Jesus. He's proven himself your friend and someone who loves you. Even the best Christian among us has not proven that. Probably the best Christian ever written about was the Apostle Paul, who was killing Christians and executing them and hauling them off to jail and torturing them before he became a Christian. He did not prove himself a friend to Christ until later in his life, and he had a lot to make up for, you could say. And he was still one of the best examples of a Christian on this earth. Jesus has proven himself our friend. He has proven it. He has shown us. By being on earth and teaching, and allowing himself to be captured, allowing himself to be born in a smelly, stinky stable instead of a mansion or a palace, allowing himself not just to be killed, but to be brutally beaten and made fun of and tortured. He was tortured. Jesus himself was tortured before the crucifixion even took place. Part of that helped fulfill prophecy. He died before the Sabbath day was over, and he needed to be. Pilate, the Bible records Pilate saying, well, he's dead already? Well, that was fast. A crucifixion was a brutal death. It took days to die. Days. Sometimes as many as 3 or 4. Honestly, I mean, on top of the beating and just hanging there, you probably died of starvation. Dehydration. And of course, they mocked him and gave him something to drink. Vinegar and a sponge. Terrible trick. But I want to thank you for watching my videos. I'm sorry. I've been a little bit of a downer today. I mean, this time of year, Easter is kind of it's both a glorious thing and a downing thing. All he suffered and went through. And I don't want to make you feel guilty about what Jesus did for you. I just want you to realize what he did. And that touches your heart in a kind of a condemning way. I do apologize, but maybe if it helps you understand who he is and what he did, it's done its job. I don't wish to make anyone unhappy. I wish to encourage you. But there are facts and things and truths that are unpleasant truths, but it doesn't take away their truth. I want to thank you for watching, and I hope to see you next time. I'll spill the beans. My next video, I'm hoping, is a Star Wars type of video. And yes, there will be gospel music. You're wondering, how is that possible? Well, tune in on May 27th to find out. I believe it's a Thursday. And why May 27th? Well, that's the release of the original 1977 Star Wars movie, the first one. I was thinking about doing it on May the 4th, but I'm on duty for work, and I'm not going to have time to practice and get stuff ready like I want to. So, I actually... And maybe I'll also read another thing. Like, I read something today. I might read something else next time. I actually wrote a Star Wars gospel message in my yearbook. I know, at the time, I was 18. I wanted to be a pastor, preacher, and I wanted to prepare a Bible lesson based off of Star Wars. And I read it recently, And good Lord, is it corny. I like to think I write much better now, and I could probably do the same thing in a much better way now, but it was a sincere attempt. But I hope you'll tune in next month. I might have a video in between there. I don't know. We'll see how God leads and the time I get and how I'm feeling. I think I can feel allergies coming on again. And I'm trying to manage it, but no promises. But I hope to see you again. And I hope we can have some fun and learn and rejoice together. But thank you for tuning in. And I hope to see you next time.